This week on Cracked Science, we look into the rumors that expertise is dead. What do we know about the public's trust in scientists? I thought I knew, and then I read this one paper that changed everything. Hey, this is Jonathan Jayer, and you're watching Cracked Science, a show for the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. I want to talk about this book, The Death of Expertise by Tom Nichols, which got a ton of media coverage when it came out in 2017. Basically, its author argues that today, people dismiss experts and raise themselves to their level. And as much as it scares me, I want to believe that because it sounds true. We hear about fake news, post-truth, Dr. Google, the war on science. But I don't know that I can trust a book that doesn't provide a lot of data. Nichols' claim that we dismiss expertise, often with anger, and especially in the US, is backed up mostly by his own personal perception of the situation, combined with what some people have told him over the years. Those are anecdotes. I have anecdotes of my own. For the past 4 years, I've co-hosted a podcast which features a Vox Pop segment. We talk to random people on the street and we ask them about what they know about fasting, concussions, vaccines, allergies. And in my experience, many people are quick to point out they don't know enough about the topic. They've heard things, but they don't know enough to be sure. So we need data to figure out what's going on, both in the US and elsewhere, because otherwise we risk falling prey to the kids these days bias. You know how kids these days can't write good English? Where have all the good writers gone, one may ask. Indeed, every generation thinks kids these days have gotten worse at mastering their language. It's a linguistic end times until the people they criticize get old enough to lament the declining standards of their own kids. So we're going to look at the data that we have, not opinions, not perceptions, but actual data on this alleged death of expertise and the claim that this is a relatively recent phenomenon. And because we've only got 10 minutes, we're going to focus on scientific expertise. Nichols claims in his book that the death of expertise is not just a rejection of existing knowledge, it is fundamentally a rejection of science. Right, so we distrust science more than ever, right? I mean, the year the death of expertise came out, the CBC told us very clearly that almost half of Canadians think science is a matter of opinion. This, by the way, was based on a survey commissioned by the Ontario Science Centre that was scary, like, post-truth world, here I come. Scary. Indeed, 43% of poll Canadians said that science is a matter of opinion. Cue the death of expertise. But in the same survey, 81% of Canadians said they believed science is based on objective facts, and the same number believed scientific findings are objective facts. Come again? Those numbers, they're from the same survey. Okay, here's another scary finding from this survey. Nearly 1 in 3 Canadians don't understand, believe in, or trust science reported in the news. First of all, this is about trust in the media about science, not trust in science. But also, I don't know if you caught this little sleight of hand trick here. 1 in 3 Canadians either don't believe in science reported in the news, they don't trust it, or they don't understand it. One of these things is not like the other. One of these things just doesn't belong. Not trusting someone who speaks French is very different from not understanding someone who speaks French. So one flawed survey isn't going to cut it. If we want to know whether or not people still trust scientists, we're going to need to look at a lot of survey data. And you know what it sounds like? Voting coverage. We start our coverage tonight with the province of Quebec, where 82% of the public trusts Quebec scientists. Across the Quebec-Ontario border, trust is even higher, with 88% of Ontarians expressing a similar level of trust in scientists in general, and roughly the same number trusting educational institutions. And we have some breaking news from the 2019 3M survey. Looking at the naysayers, between 32 and 36% of Americans, Canadians, and Brits say they somewhat or completely agree with the statement that they are skeptical of science. However, when asked about trust in scientists, trust in science, and believing in scientific claims, 80 to 90% of the same survey takers responded positively. In fact, people in all three countries are much more likely to trust science coming from actual scientific experts than from news outlets or social media. Looking at the United Kingdom, we see that trust in scientists has increased by 20% over the past two decades. In fact, the five most trusted professions in terms of truth-telling in the UK are nurses, doctors, teachers, professors, and scientists, with journalists way down the poll at 27%. And we have some historical data which shows significant increase in public trust for both professors and scientists since the 1980s and 90s. And we move over to the United States, where the situation is, shall we say, more complicated. Our analysts tell us that scientists are the only group among the 13 institutions covered by the National Opinion Research Center where public confidence has remained stable since the 1970s. 21% of the American public has a great deal of trust in scientists, and 55% have a fair amount of trust, adding up to 76%. All right, if this were an election, I'd say scientists would have a fair chance of winning. I think it's naive to ask 99% of the public to have blind trust in scientists, so these numbers don't scare me too much. But surveys are far from perfect. We saw it clearly with the poll commissioned by the Ontario Science Centre. Respondents are not always consistent depending on which question is asked. Overall, trust appears fairly high across the board, but there are important pockets where trust is low. When it comes to climate change, when it comes to vaccines, when we talk about genetically engineered food, that's where the distrust shows up. So if I were to try to use this information to explain why some people like Tom Nichols are perceiving a disappearing trust in scientific experts, I would raise the following points. 1. Many people trust scientists in general a good or great deal, but they have major reservations when it comes to specific topics where there's a lot of misinformation, or where the science is new and the public doesn't know much about how the risks are being mitigated, or where a person's political or religious beliefs are threatened. 2. Only half of Canadians, Americans, and Brits trust science as reported in the media, which is distinct from trusting the scientists themselves. And you know what? They have a good reason to be skeptical. That 2019 3M survey showed that the number one reason given for skepticism in science is conflicting opinions. Coffee is good for you, coffee is bad for you, canola oil is good for you, canola oil causes cancer of the Alzheimer's disease. The media has a part to play here. 3. Social media may be skewing our perception because what used to be people's private thoughts on an issue, perhaps shared around the dinner table or at a local pub, get spread and amplified on Twitter and Facebook. So the internet can easily make us think that fewer people trust experts simply because we hear this minority loud and clear. And 4, there are a lot of self-proclaimed experts on the internet who are platformed by the media, and that can only confuse people. So I was all ready to end here by saying that everything is fine, we just need to work on regaining public trust on a number of specific issues, when I saw this, the Mata paper. The Mata paper. You see, I've been showing you evidence that people still trust experts, so the death of expertise has been exaggerated. But you can still trust experts and think that you yourself are also an expert. In a survey of 1,310 American adults, Matthew Mata, Timothy Callahan, and Stephen Sylvester discovered that, when asked about the causes of autism, over a third, said they knew as much or more than doctors and scientists. And this overconfidence was seen more in people who, when tested on their actual knowledge, knew the least about autism and agreed the most with misinformation on this topic. Now, many of these people didn't poo-poo experts. They thought experts should play a major role in the policy-making process. But they also thought that non-experts should play just as major a role. A rising tide of misinformation lifts all boats. This is an example of the now infamous Dunning-Kruger effect, which is not that dumb people don't know they're dumb. It's that in any area of interest, be it vaccine science or the functioning of a bicycle, people who score in the bottom half tend to think they did better than they did, while people at the very top tend to slightly underestimate their score. You may underestimate your own knowledge of nursing if you're a good nurse, but overestimate what you know about genetically engineered food, for example. It's topic specific. So, bringing all of this to a close in simple caveman English, people trust scientists, people don't like some sciences, media confuses people, social media makes extreme voices very, very loud, and some people trust scientists, but also trust themselves way too much. We don't know that we don't know. Is any of this new? Here's Bertrand Russell in 1951. One of the painful things about our time is that those who feel certainty are stupid, and those with any imagination and understanding are filled with doubt and indecision. So is this new? Since the Dunning-Kruger effect was first described in 1999, it's going to be tough to get scientific data on it from a while back. Unless you want to count operas, because maybe Puccini was onto something in 1926.
The Dunning-Kruger trap.
There's so much more to discuss on the topic of expertise. One aspect I didn't have time to cover is the claim that we're in the midst of a narcissism epidemic, which leads us to be overconfident in our abilities even when we're not experts. If you are interested in this, I would refer you to a BBC article entitled "Millennials Are Narcissistic? The Evidence Is Not So Simple," which argues that the research into today's youth being more self-centered and egotistical than ever is not as clear as we've been led to believe. Also, I'll put in the description the link to the full video for the Dunning-Kruger song, which was written and performed for the 27th Ig Nobel Prize Award ceremony. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, do click that button and ring that bell to get notifications. Don't forget to join the thousands of people who subscribe to our weekly newsletter by going to mcgill.ca/OSS. In the meantime, you can follow me on Twitter @CrackedScience and join us next time for science that may or may not be all it's cracked up to be.